next on Unsolved Mysteries. 17-year-old Tami Lynn Liepert tells her family that someone is going to kill her. And then she vanishes. DNA evidence points to the same suspect in two murder cases. But who is he? Hundreds of credible people have experienced odd memory lapses called missing time. Some believe they were abducted by aliens. And Laura Law says that her boyfriend Mike just packed his bags and left one day. But then why was his dead body found in Laura's tool shed? Some hot cases, some cold cases, and some cases that will even shock you. I'm Dennis Farina, and this is Unsolved Mysteries. Orlando, Florida.
Tami is 16 years old.
The winner of this beauty pageant will be Tami Lynn Liepert. At the age of 16, Tami had already competed in more than 300 beauty contests and won 280 times.
Number 59.
She was very loving, kind. She was always smiling. As young as I can remember, she woke up with a great big smile, and the last thing I saw before she went to sleep was a big smile.
Tami was just 4 years old when she entered her first pageant. Her mother, a theatrical and modeling agent, guided her career.
I was constantly busy running her around to where she had to go and what she had to do. And I enjoyed it. I enjoyed watching her excel. She always went for the best that she could go for, the highest level.
Wayne Flanagan, who was 13 years old at the time, was a close family friend.
Well, I have to blot my lipstick.
He and Tami were like brother and sister.
I'm trying to watch TV.
Yeah.
She would kiss me on the cheek, and I couldn't quite ever get it completely off.
Mom, I'm leaving.
It was rather embarrassing to walk around with this mark, but I think actually I learned to wear it proudly after a while because it was almost a status symbol. Tami.
Tami landed a part in the teen exploitation film Spring Break. When it was done filming, she went on her own to a weekend party. She came back a different person. Soon, Tammy's behavior Ryan. Began to take on paranoid overtones.
I'm not here. Don't tell anybody I'm here.
Why?
Just do it.
All right. Hello?
Is Tami Lynn there?
No. She's not here right now.
Sometimes I'd ask her what was on her mind, if anything was bothering her.
Bye.
And she'd usually change the subject, or she'd say, oh, nothing, you know, and then try to laugh it off.
Tami, what's the problem?
I saw something awful.
What?
Something really bad.
She said that she saw something so horrible that she couldn't talk about it.
Sweetheart, talk to me.
And she said, Mom, what would you say if I told you somebody was trying to kill me? I just took a deep breath and I said, do you think somebody's trying to kill you, Tami? She said, yes.
Tami,
can't tell anybody. I can't.
What do you mean you can't tell anybody?
I kept trying to find out who they were.
Tami, talk to me.
She never would tell me.
Tami?
Tami also kept more to herself. Her mother and Wing couldn't figure out whether her fears were real or paranoid delusions.
Taste this.
Why?
Just do it.
Once she said, look across the street and tell me what you see. Said, well, the neighbor's got a new van. And she said, exactly. And You know, I didn't know quite what she was getting at. And she said, the van has mirrored windows. That means that they can see us, but we can't see them.
After spending 2 weeks in seclusion, Tami accepted an offer for a small part in a big-budget Al Pacino film, Scarface, which was shooting in Miami. There, she stayed with a family friend, Walter Leibowitz. She seemed fine until the fourth day of filming.
I received a call from the casting director to tell me that Tami had a breakdown on the set. They said that there was a scene where someone was supposed to be shot and they had artificial blood spurted out. And they said when Tami was watching the scene, she started crying hysterically and it got so bad that they had her take her to a trailer.
Tami, what's happened?
They're gonna kill me.
Who's gonna kill you?
They're gonna kill me.
She was in a tremendous state of fear, anxiety.
Who's trying to hurt you? They're gonna blow my head off like this.
Hysterically crying, saying something about money laundering. I don't know where to hide, things of that nature. What it was that caused this great fear in her, I don't know. When I spoke with Tammy's mother, I told her that she should take Tami to a doctor and also take her to the police to find out if the problem was psychological or if there was some basis in fact that someone was actually trying to kill her and get to the bottom of it.
Tami quit the film and went back home. Her mother insisted that she talk to the local sheriff about her fears. But Tami apparently never mentioned to the sheriff that she felt that her life was in danger.
There were good days and there were bad days. There were days when she was almost normal, almost. And there were other days when she was real edgy.
And then one day, Tami finally snapped.
Crazy look in her eyes. She wasn't her. I don't think she really knew who I was.
I knew then, right then, that I handled that incident. But I didn't know if I was going to be able to handle the next one.
Tami's mother checked her into a mental health center for a complete physical and psychiatric evaluation. Doctors found no evidence of drug or alcohol use. After 72 hours of observation, Tami was released.
Yes, we will have a photographer.
That next day, everything seemed to be extraordinarily normal.
Absolutely.
Yes. Mom, I'll be back in a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
Bye.
Yes.
I suddenly got frightened, real frightened, and I went to the door and opened it, and I just knew right then it was the last time I was going to see her.
This friend picked her up at her home, and they drove to the beach. And we talked to him, and he basically stated that they'd become involved in a verbal argument.
Just stop it!
What do you want me to do?
I just want you to shut up!
She had requested that he let her out near the glass bank in Cocoa Beach, and he complied. As far as we know, that was the last person to see Tami alive. She disappeared without a trace. We talked to some of her close friends. They felt strongly that Tami was having problems at home.
We will have a photographer.
And that she had left home.
There's no conceivable way I would believe it. Because first of all, she was getting ready to go to California for 3 months. That's as far away from me as you could get, from Cocoa Beach to California. And she was really excited about going. What reason would she have for running away? No clothes? If somebody runs away, they take their clothes. They take their money. They take their personal possessions.
Tami knew something she shouldn't have about someone that she was very frightened of. Sometimes I feel if I had asked her rather than told her that it was in her imagination, maybe she would still be here.
This interview was taped during Tammy's final beauty pageant.
Sometimes things that seem like the best aren't the best, and things that don't seem so good are the best. But I'll do my best no matter what.
Tami Lynn Liepert is 5 feet 4 inches tall, and at the time of her disappearance weighed 103 pounds. She has blonde hair and hazel eyes. If you have any information about the disappearance of Tami Lynn Liepert, please log on to our website at unsolved.com. Coming up, two crimes of rape and murder. Both victims wore red shoes. Is there any connection? Fairfax County, Virginia. A worker surveying an out-of-the-way wooded area makes a gruesome discovery. The partially clothed body of a young woman lies in a clearing. She has been shot and sexually assaulted. Her jeans, purse, and red shoes are piled neatly nearby.
Once the police arrived on the scene, they began cordoning off the area. As they were stretching the crime scene tape and walking the area, they discovered a second body nearby.
The young man had been shot once in the head, execution style. The victims were 22-year-old Rachel Raver and her boyfriend Warren Fulton. Their murders would remain unsolved for more than a decade. However, advances in forensic science would produce a major break in the case. Warren Fulton was the captain of his university baseball team and hoped to one day play in the major leagues. Rachel Raver was a well-liked recent graduate who was planning to go to law school. They had been dating for several months.
Bye, guys.
The night they were killed, Rachel and Warren met friends for drinks at a Washington, D.C. bar. They were last seen walking to their car at around 12:30 a.m.
It's my belief that they probably encountered someone near their car or on their way to the car.
Just tell us where you want us to go.
Can we just give him the car?
Investigators believe that Rachel and Warren were probably abducted at gunpoint and forced to drive from Washington into the Virginia suburbs. Once they got to the wooded area, the gunmen apparently wasted no time.
Can you leave us here and take the car? Don't hurt us, please.
Warren was probably killed as soon as they got into the woods. People would have seen that. We think probably at that point she ran.
After mortally wounding Rachel, the killer sexually assaulted her. Police believe he then fled in Rachel's car, unaware that he had left behind clues to his identity. Semen recovered from Rachel's body contained his DNA.
I didn't feel angry for several months, and then one day I got up and I got mad. And my attitude was, who the hell does he think he is? And that's when I started healing and looking for him.
Here you go.
Rachel's mother and sister went over every detail of the case. They became convinced that finding Rachel's missing car was the key to tracking down the killer. Even though she lived in New York City, Rachel's mother, Veronica, spent all her free time driving the streets and highways around Washington, D.C., looking for the car.
I would stop at those wayside rest areas all the way down to D.C., all the way back on the other side of the highway. I was obsessed.
Just as Veronica was losing hope of ever finding the car, there was a major break.
I came home from work and I took the mail from the motor vehicle for tickets. And when I opened it up, I thought, whoa,
God.
Rachel's missing Toyota sedan had been ticketed for illegal parking on a street in Queens, New York. The date on the ticket was the day after the murders and 2 days before the bodies were discovered.
The car was sitting unattended on a New York City street, so you can imagine what happened to it. By the time it was recovered, there wasn't much left of it. The car was taken to a garage in New York City where it was processed extensively, and a number of latent fingerprints were developed, and we weren't able to identify anyone. So basically, we came away with no clues from the car.
And then, almost a full year after the murders, Veronica was watching our program when a story caught her attention. A young woman had been found murdered in an Arlington, Virginia schoolyard. She had been sexually assaulted and shot once at point-blank range. The victim was 24-year-old Veronica Jefferson, who lived in the Washington, D.C. area.
One good suspect admitted that he had seen her the day that she was killed, and he was able to describe her all the way down to her red shoes.
The date was also Rachel's birthday that got my attention. It's something about it. I called up my daughter Dee Dee and asked her to check on this. Something about it bothered me.
When I spoke to the detective about it, he told me that he had looked into the case too, because it bothered him a lot. But the case was so different, and her killer seemed to know her. And we assumed that in Rachel's case that it was a stranger.
The cases seemed very different. Rachel was white and Veronica was African American. Rachel had been with her boyfriend and Veronica was alone. And while investigators thought Veronica knew her killer, they suspected that the attack on Rachel and Warren had been random. Years passed, and the murders of Rachel Raver and Warren Fulton remained unsolved. The break happened at Virginia State's DNA lab. A technician was running routine comparisons on DNA samples submitted by law enforcement agencies.
I received a phone call from the serologist at our lab, and she says, I've got good news and I've got bad news. The good news is we got a hit on your case in the Virginia data bank. The bad news is the hit is on another unsolved homicide.
That other homicide was the murder of Veronica Jefferson. There was now scientific proof Rachel, Warren, and Veronica were all killed by the same person. Investigators had confirmation that a serial killer was on the loose.
My husband got a phone call from the detectives, and they told him that they had a cold DNA hit. And it matched another case that was 7 months after our daughter, and it was the Fulton and the Ravers case. And shortly afterwards, Deidre Raver got in touch with us.
When I met the Jeffersons, it was as if I had known them for years. For the last 12 years, we've been grieving on the very same day.
Once we make the DNA link between these murders, and then we can go back and we can closer examine these murders, we start to see some small similarities. The red shoes are fascinating. I think it's probably more than coincidental, though, that they were both wearing red shoes. In the Arlington County case, they have a composite drawing of a suspect. They have a face to go with the DNA, and we never had that before.
I won't rest until he's found. I really won't have any peace until he's found. He's an evil predator. An evil, perverted predator. He's dangerous.
I like for him to go through the pain and the hurt that I have gone through for 13 years. I would like to see him face to face.
Update. An inmate on California's death row has now been charged with the murders of Rachel Raver, Warren Fulton, and Veronica Jefferson. Alfredo Rolando Prieto was not yet in prison at the time they were gunned down, and DNA taken from Prieto matched samples recovered from the crime scenes. A jury convicted Prieto of two murder counts for the slaying of Rachel Raver and Warren Fulton. The judge then upheld the jury's recommendation that Alfredo Prieto be executed for his crimes. Coming up, after her boyfriend disappears, Laura Law doesn't want anyone looking in the shed on her property. What could she be hiding? Arkdale, Wisconsin. Laura Law and her boyfriend Mike Telesti were together for 11 years. Their close friends, Denise Piccioni and her husband, were often guests in their home. Denise was Laura's best friend. She was also Mike's cousin.
Laura was good to Mike. I saw Mike very happy. I never saw them argue or fight. And they were a lot of fun to be with.
Where is it?
Calm down.
Where is the money? Huh? We're almost broke.
But one night, Laura and Mike did argue when he found Laura at a nearby casino gambling with Denise.
She was just trembling. She was shaking. And I said, well, what's wrong? And she said, I don't know. He's depressed. Something's wrong with him. We gotta go.
Yeah, tomorrow. I'll call you tomorrow.
After that night, Mike Telesti was never seen again. Mike's family and friends admit that his behavior in the casino may have been a bit unusual, but to completely avoid contact with them didn't make sense. The only person who claimed to know where Mike went was his longtime girlfriend, Laura Law, but she too would disappear.
Please don't go.
I gotta go.
Laura said that when they returned from the casino, Mike packed some clothes and $73,000 in cash. She said that it came from the graphics business they owned. He then left on foot from their home in the middle of the night.
I said, that's so strange. He left on foot? And she said, yeah, this doesn't make any sense. And she said, well, I think he had a trucker pick him up.
He's my cousin. He's like the sweetest guy in the world. Why would he just disappear?
That's what I want to know.
I thought she was lying, but I thought she was trying to cover her embarrassment. Maybe he said, I'm leaving you for another woman. And then 2 weeks after Mike disappeared, she called me up and she goes, well, he just called and he's out west. And I said, well, when's he coming home? She goes, well, I asked him, are you ready to come home yet? And he said, no.
4 months passed and there was still no sign of Mike. Because Mike and Laura ran their own business, few people even knew that he was gone. But by midsummer, Denise insisted Laura talk to Mike's parents. Laura had still not told them about Mike's strange disappearance.
I'm going to tell him that he's on an extended fishing trip in Winnipeg.
What?
And I said, this is going on too long. If this was my son, I'd be furious if somebody didn't tell me that he's been missing.
I don't want to worry them.
I don't care. You've got to tell them, all right?
All right, okay, I'll tell them the truth.
To Denise's surprise, Laura lied to Mike's mother anyway. She told her that Mike had gone to Canada.
It was so bizarre. It scared me that she would be so underhanded to plot and say, this is what we're gonna say.
Now suspicious, Denise began to remember other times when Laura's behavior seemed odd.
I'm gonna come today and get my snowmobiles, okay?
Well, sure, but I don't have the keys.
Denise's snowmobiles were stored in a lock shed in Mike and Laura's backyard. But Laura Law seemed determined to prevent anyone from going in that shed.
I don't know what's going on with you, but for the past 3 weeks, every time I called about the snowmobiles, you have some other reason why I can't come get them.
I said, Laura, if you don't have the snowmobiles out of that shed, I'm coming with a locksmith, and I'll replace the locks and pay for it and give you new keys and new locks. I said, but I need my snowmobiles.
I'm telling you something. If that shed isn't open, I'm going to break it open.
Denise?
Law had removed the snowmobiles by herself and still wouldn't let anyone into the shed. The thought now crossed Denise's mind that a clue to Mike's disappearance might be hidden in there.
It was the straw that broke the camel's back. I called Mike's brother and I said, Mark, we have to talk. I said, something's wrong. Something's terrible wrong.
Mike's brother immediately filed a missing persons report with the local authorities.
Because of the way the stories weren't jiving and things didn't add up and no one's heard from him, I didn't hesitate at all. And he left everything, and that also made me very suspicious that something happened to him.
Did you find anything?
No. Laura seemed to be very cooperative the day that we were there. She also invited me to look around on the property if I desired.
What do you normally keep in the shed?
We usually...
Laura threw a roadblock in front of me when I asked to go into that building.
Can we take a look?
Actually, I cleared all of that stuff out a couple months ago so that I could rent it.
Do you have a key?
Oh, no. The man I rented it to has the key.
Laura said that she would arrange for her renter to open the shed. But shortly after the investigators left, Laura Law disappeared. It was several months before authorities were granted a warrant to search the shed.
The minute that we stepped inside, I could smell the strong, pungent odor of what I believed to be that of a decomposing human body.
Oh boy. Under several pieces of wood and covered in a blanket and plastic wrapping was Mike's decomposed body. He had been dead for 9 to 10 months.
The autopsy showed cause of death was attributed to a single gunshot wound to the back of the victim's head. Several years before the incident, Laura Law had purchased a 9mm handgun. We believe that that is the weapon that was used in the homicide of Michael Tulusty.
Despite the evidence, those who knew Laura Law were shocked to think that she had murdered Mike.
I was with her for 11 years and I thought she was a wonderful person. Did I know her at all? Is Laura the one that we had so much fun with and did things with? Is that Laura? Or is this Laura the one that shot him? Who is Laura? What happened? That's bottom line. What happened?
I'm almost sure that she has a gambling problem.
Let's go.
And I think that's probably what triggered this.
We're about broke.
Mike.
Where is it?
Michael may have told her that enough was enough and that she needed to consider leaving. And Laura didn't want to leave that relationship and didn't want to leave the life as she knew it.
Update. Laura Law has been caught. FBI agents were tipped off that she was working the night shift at a motel in Nashville, Tennessee. When she arrived at work, she was taken into custody. Law pleaded guilty to murder and was sentenced to 24 years in prison. She is not eligible for parole and will not be released until 2026. In a moment, an Air Force sergeant disappears for 1 hour, but doesn't remember being gone. Was he abducted by aliens? Hundreds of people claim they have had a bizarre experience called missing time. You're about to meet one of them, a member of the Air Force who disappeared for an entire hour. Under hypnosis, he describes his abduction, believe it or not, by aliens. North Truro, Massachusetts. Shortly before 9 p.m., a bus pulled up in front of Dutra's Market in this small Cape Cod town. Only one man got off the bus, 19-year-old Airman First Class Robert Matthews. He was reporting for his first tour of duty at a nearby Air Force base. He noticed that the area was deserted.
I got off where the bus driver told me where I was supposed to get off, and he told me to phone the base and they would send a truck down to pick me up. I told him that I was in front of Dutra's Market. And he told me to stay there and that there would be a truck there to pick me up in a minute. While I was standing there, I saw these lights, you know, moving from right to left across the sky. That's when I felt the spear, you know, and I said, I better call the base.
Hello, this is Hammond Matthews. Yes, sir. Yes, I've been here all the time.
When I called the base again, they asked me where I've been, and he told me, he says, well, we sent a truck down there already. And I says, well, I've been standing here waiting, and no one's been by here.
Matthew!
Matthews was told that at 8:50, just 5 minutes after his first phone call, a driver had arrived to pick him up. The driver claimed that Matthews was nowhere in sight. Almost an hour later, at 9:45, the base had received the second call from Matthews. Oddly, he thought that the two calls were made just a few minutes apart.
It's a kind of a mini period of amnesia. This is what the missing time phenomenon really is. It is not perceived as a break in which something happens and then a resumption. Time is remembered as continuous, and yet the half-hour trip turns out to be a two-hour trip or whatever. This is sometimes experienced in conjunction with a UFO sighting, but not always.
Bud Hopkins has written several books on the subject of missing time and alien abduction.
I began getting phone calls from people and letters, and many of their sighting reports had pieces of missing time in them. And we began looking into those cases and discovered one after another of these abduction cases.
Robert Matthews was one of the people who contacted Bud Hopkins.
I was on vacation looking for something to read, and on the shelf there in front of me, I saw this book with this creature on it. I read the book, and I thought someone had stepped into my head and taken my innermost fears and put them in a book. It brought tears to my eyes. You know, I couldn't believe this was actually happening to someone else.
When Bob called me, it had that familiar ring of truth to me, as did the details of his case. He was quite convinced that this was not a dream. He sounded troubled, curious, very, very stable.
It's all along the Cape, and it's all new and all kind of interesting.
Hopkins put Bob under hypnosis to explore the details about what happened to him outside of Dutra's Market.
Something was really, really wrong, because all of a sudden I got very afraid.
Bob Matthews' case is really a typical and very good missing time case, because the fact that there is an indirect witness to his having been missing during a missing time period is very important.
Bob's memories were so vivid that he was able to return to Cape Cod and reconstruct what he believes took place outside Dutra's Market.
Under hypnosis, I observed in the sky three lights moving in this direction. They hovered over here, and the red one came at me so fast. I can see some light come from a crack. It's like a ramp opens down, and I can see a lot of light come out of there. I walked up to it, walked up the ramp, and I looked inside, and I saw four beings sitting over here on the left. There was two sitting on the right, and the place reminded me of a doctor's office.
Every single case, we came out with a scenario which was exactly like the other scenarios. They're taken into a craft, a landed UFO, put on a table, clothes are removed, samples are taken during that time, sometimes blood samples, but often skin scrapings, and very often sperm and ova samples. The descriptions that we're getting of the UFO occupants, about 85%, are extremely similar. The figures are little, between 3.5 and 5 feet tall. Extremely slender, they have a grayish white skin, they have very large craniums, the eyes are often very, very black, the mouth is a slit which never seems to move, and there's no ears. I'm the first one to admit how outrageous all of this is. The people to whom it happens also say, this just can't happen.
I went through all my life doubting my sanity, wondering whether or not these things have occurred.
Coming up, the strangest accounts of missing time, invasive medical exams, by alien creatures.
Abductions by aliens. The idea seems unbelievable, even to those who claimed it happened to them. But some take their stories even one step further. They say they've been victims of experiments by aliens, and they claim to have physical evidence to prove it.
Sometimes I even think it's harder for people like us to believe it than the outside, you know, people that it hasn't happened to.
Now, of course, I mean, you know, I get up in the morning and say, no, that can't be, just, it's ridiculous.
Nobody's ever been through this one, ever wished.
Bud Hopkins has organized support groups so that people who believe they are victims of missing time and alien abduction can compare their disturbing experiences.
The big question is, why me?
Yeah.
I think we all ask.
I was utterly skeptical. I thought it was complete hogwash, hocus pocus, abducted by aliens, except for the fact that there were these patients of mine who I knew to be very trustworthy, very honest, very uncrazy people.
How many experiences does each of you remember having or think you've had?
I would say at least 10. I mean, 10 that I know of. And
Christina
and I have
Florence
done.
Is a New York choreographer who feels she has had multiple experiences of missing time and alien abduction.
I can't use those words, abducted by aliens. I just don't know what it was. I know that some people came and did some things to me, but where do they come from? I don't know.
Christina was 17 years old when she, her mother, and her older sister crossed the Mojave Desert on their way to San Francisco. Near Barstow, California, their car overheated, so they exited the highway at a local park.
You girls stay in the car, roll up the windows, and lock the door.
We're having a problem with this engine. I have to go get some water.
At that point, she just walked away.
You're not supposed to go outside. You said to stay in the car.
Well, I am doing it.
My sister got out of the car, and I heard her run around the back. And all of a sudden, she said, oh, my God, come out here quick. And the next thing I remembered consciously was that we were lying on this blanket in the middle of the park as if we'd had a little nap, just lying there. Our mom was still not around, and we woke up, and we were like, whoa, what happened? And then the next thing I remember, three of us were just driving like hell. We never talked about it until my sister just called me up one day, and we sort of began to talk about it further and realized that we'd both had this very bizarre memory of this missing time thing. And she knew about Bud, and she suggested that I get in touch with Bud.
So she had to sort of crank up her courage to look into it, and it was reluctant. She was reluctant to do so.
From New Mexico.
Christina agreed to undergo hypnosis, hoping that she can recall some details about what happened that afternoon.
At some point, the mother pulls off the road. You can feel the car move as it turns off the road, and you can see your mother, and you can see yourself there. You're there with Vicky.
I start having this picture that my sister's getting out of the car, and then I get out of the car, and I looked up, and there was something above the car. And I was so scared, I didn't know what it was. I ran back to the car, and she ran back, and she got herself crunched under the dashboard. She was so scared, and I was trying to start the car, and it wouldn't start.
I don't know what they're doing.
Then the next memory that I had under the hypnosis was that I was on a table, and there were some people around.
It's like they're pulling on my leg.
There was this screen. It was about as wide as a large television screen, but it was paper thin. And it was just moving around the table, and it wasn't attached to anything. And I could see three-dimensional shapes of my skull and my, you know, my whole body. It was just taking pictures. And it was just this huge spherical room that was just covered with dials. There wasn't a space. It was just dials. And I felt like they put, like, these rubber pants on me or something with things attached. And then they left the room. And I lay there, and I was asking for my sister, and somebody was telling me, she's okay, she's all right. And the dial started going, and then they came back in, and that's the last thing I remember. Then we were back on the grass.
Christine Florence, I think, is without a doubt, absolute, utterly, totally legit. She is a very trustworthy, very honest person who I've talked to several times. and she's angry about what's happened to her. She doesn't like what's happened to her. She's been able to incorporate it into her life and get on with her life despite this.
And go and step.
I live a perfectly normal life. You know, I have a dance company. I go to work every day. I have an apartment. I have two cats. I have a perfectly normal life. I'm not crazy. There's definitely something going on. And what it is, I don't know. I could be having a dream, and everyone else is having the same dream. But I'm not lying. And I'm not crazy.
I mean, I had incredible...
If these abductions really did happen, then the question is, why?
Ultimately, the focus becomes reproductive, and the interest seems to have to do with taking sperm and ova samples. The whole central focus of the physical part of it seems to deal with the idea of an ongoing genetic experiment, and these abductees are, let's say, involuntary victims or specimen in this ongoing genetic experiment.
A lot of us have had false pregnancies, miscarriages after 3 months of pregnancy, abortions where nothing was found.
And I wish the people that ridiculed us could live one day and one night in my body. But I don't want anybody to go through what I live with.
The numbers of cases, the amount of emotional distress, the consistency of the accounts, the physical marks, the weight of the evidence is so powerful now that even if I wished for the luxury of disbelief, it's not possible for me anymore.
We're stuck, really, trying to make sense out of something that doesn't make sense. But that is no reason to dismiss it out of hand.
I would really like to get to the bottom of it someday. I'd really like to know what it's about, because the hard part of it is just not knowing.
Perhaps someday science will discover a reason for missing time. Until then, the rest of us should be glad that all of our minutes have been accounted for.